Welcome to this session on digital concept visualization. My name is Sanjay Vyas. Today we'll be looking at compilation process and process map. So let's start. To compile a program, we need to write source code. So here is a simple source code in C language, which does printf hello. Of course, the computer does not understand this, and we would have to convert it into a language understood by the computer, and that is the object code, also known as binary code. This is the piece of code which the compiler can understand and execute. However, we cannot run this code right now because we have used a function printf which we haven't written. So we need a step called the linker phase. So what does the linker do? Linker finds the functions that we have used from libraries like this and adds them along with our object code to generate what is known as the executable. Now this piece of code is ready to execute. This is usually stored in some storage media like the disk, and a ready object code is known as a program. However, to run this program, we need to bring it into the memory and execute it. When we say run or launch or execute, the program is picked up from the disk and brought into the memory. But it's not just a dump of program on the disk. Instead, the loader loads the program, breaks it up into different parts, and arranges it in the RAM. By now, the program has been converted into a process. And that is the difference between a program and a process. In simple terms, a process is a program which is executing in memory. But program, as we discussed, is not just a dump of the, process is not just the dump of the program. So a process is actually made up of multiple parts. These parts are referred to as segments or sections. So let's explore what these parts are. First thing, the code that we compiled into binary, which converted into an executable, those parts of binary code are brought into a segment called code segment. So we have to main what we have written and printf what we have used. This code segment is also referred to as text segment in operating systems like Linux. Next, we have two segments for holding global and static data. They are referred to as Bss block, started by symbol. Bss contains all the global and static data, which were either initialized to zero or were left uninitialized and therefore became zero. So all global and static data, which are zero, are stored in Bss. There is another segment called data. This is also global and static. The difference being, all of these are non-zero to begin with. So combined, Bss and data are two segments holding global and static data. Interesting to note is that they will not move their position if the values change. So if this 5 becomes 0, it will not pick itself up and walk over to the other side. These are the starting position. Thereafter, they can keep changing their values, but they stay where they are. There is another segment called stack. And just like the data structure stack, it's a LIFO structure. Last in, first out. Stack is made up of stack frames. So every time a function executes, like main, it immediately creates a stack frame. And the stack frame is made up of multiple parts. So let's examine them. The first one is the return address. The second one, formal parameters passed to the function, also known as arguments. But I believe the correct technical terms for variables defined in the function signature is formal parameters. The third one, any local variables that function has defined, they are stored in the stack frame. And the last one is the return value that the function would be returning back. Interesting to note, we may have hundreds of functions. That does not mean when the program starts, hundreds of stack frames are created and kept ready. No. A stack frame is created only when a function is called. So let's say at this point, main calls this function printf. Now the moment that happens, a stack frame for printf is created. And just like main, it will have its own return address, its formal parameters, local variables, and return value. This leaves us with just one area in the process map which doesn't seem to be holding anything. Well, because it's special. This is known as the heap. Heap is an empty area, deliberately kept empty at the beginning of the program, because if the program requires more memory after it starts running, this is the place where the program can go and reserve some memory. For example, an application which processes student records but doesn't know how many students will join. And therefore, after the program executes, it'll ask, so how many students in this batch? And when that happens, it would go and allocate memory in the heap. It gets an address of memory that it would point to. Whenever we say malloc, calloc, or new in C++ and other languages. So this is what the process map looks like. 5 segments, code, BSS, data, stack and heap. Stack frame containing return address, formal parameters, local variables and return value. And a heap which can be reserved with call to malloc, calloc and new. So this brings us to an end of a quick session on process map. If you're more interested, more such videos will be uploaded soon. And I would also be giving details on how to join the group where digital CVs will be created, discussed, and distributed. Thank you for watching, and this is Sanjay Vyas signing off.